Jesus at the center of it all.
Very good morning, everyone. Since there are not that many testimonies, I thought I'd share one. This regards our school that we have started last year. Many of you know how the Lord led us to start this school. And when we first started it, there was only about 9 students. How we started that, for a long time, it's 2014. So 2013, Clean and Michael and a few others said, we need to start a school like this. But I put it off saying that, you know, we got no time to get involved in a school. We don't have the resources to start a school. And then, so I said, why don't you all start it as a business venture and rent the premises from the church? But somehow, the people holding the franchise for this school didn't want to give it to any private individual, even though we tried our best. We said, no. They came back, we tried again, and we said, okay, maybe the school, the church form a joint venture with you guys, but you take the responsibility for all the financial losses and everything else, and so that the church is not involved. And again, we couldn't get the franchise owner to give it to us. So finally, I said, okay, I want to see the school, what they are doing, and let's have a look. And I think I remember telling you this, that when I went to that school, there were quite a number of students, of 100-200 students there, but what touched me most was when I went to that classroom with students with special needs, and there was this teacher teaching them. These are people who are a bit slow learners and so on, and then they have a big tub of rice in the center, and a mat with some cushions in the center too. So I said, what is all this? He said, oh, when these child get agitated, then we ask them put their hands into the whole tub of rice, and then when they hold it after a while, then they get more relaxed, and then they go back and do their studies. And I distinctly heard the Lord say to me, he said, that's why I want you to start this school. That's why you need to start this school so that the church can touch the people who have no chance of going for education. So, okay, this is what you say, Lord, then we start. And you know the story, how the Lord just brought Jennifer along, brought different ones along, and the school was started last year. We started with 9 students. Today, I think we have about 40 students already. God is good. Amen? And all along, we see the hand of God, the fingerprints of God, how He brought Jennifer, how He brought different ones in, how He provided for different things, how some people also, some of our church members also provided scholarship for those who cannot afford. I think something like 5 students in our school are now sponsored by people, by some of you here. So the Lord is good in that sense too. But more than anything else, you know, deep inside I knew the Lord wanted us to start a class for special children. But I always thought, well, Lord, we only have 40 people. We want to start a class, you know? Less than 40 at that time. Let's start a school, a class for special students, where to get the teachers, how to get in. But early this year, somebody wrote in to us and said, I've gone through this special course. I left my job at a bank. I went through this special course to teach children with special needs. And I want now to, I'm looking for a job. I want to serve in the school. Will you take me in? You know, so suddenly, you know, I was completely unprepared for it. And then this lady wrote in and said, I want to serve, I want to teach. So the people involved, Jennifer and the rest, interviewed her and so on and said she's very suitable. And so early this year, March this year, we started a class for special students, you know. And then we have one student with cerebral palsy there. The only school that will take her is our school because he comes in a wheelchair. You know, and that's the only school that has a lift to take them up to the classroom. You know, so God is good. I just want to tell you that every time we hear God speaking, He provides in every way. Amen? Hallelujah. He is so good. And so I want to believe that because of this school, we are not just giving an education. We are going to produce young people who will understand and know that God loves them and God has a purpose for their lives. And so in the years to come, we're going to see the society around us, the community around us change because of what God is doing in this school. Amen? Hallelujah. I thought I just wanted to tell you this because many of you don't know what is happening throughout the whole week, but many exciting things are happening throughout the whole week on our first floor in the school. Amen? God is good. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Okay, that's my little testimony. I also, like Alice, wanted to share many times, but somehow forgot about it. I think the other thing, I just want to make a special appeal. I know many families are away this weekend, some in Penang, some different groups are in Europe, some are in US, and so on. So I counted 30, 40 people away this week. But never mind, I thought, for those of you who are still left here, thank you for coming. Glad you are here. And I want to just encourage you to sign up for family camp. Okay? Can I encourage you to sign up for family camp? We're going to have great time together as a family coming together as a church, learning together, getting to know some other people in this church that you have no chance to know, eating together, playing together, learning together. And we're going to have Rob Rufus. I heard him 6-7 years ago in his church in Hong Kong. And he's a wonderful man of God. He's coming with a wife. And now he tells me his daughter, who is also a worship leader, and the husband will also be joining in. And so we're going to have a great time together listening to him, because God is using him in different places of the world. Recently, in March, he was in Manila and spoke to a conference of pastors, and now 30, 40 of them want to come over here. We have already got 4 people registered from Cambodia coming, and we also have people from Singapore who are also said that they are coming. So different people are wanting to come, and so if you can help to register by registering early, so that the home church, at least we know our numbers and we can make the preparations accordingly. Amen? Is that okay with you? Okay, so make a beeline for the registration counter. They want your payment so that they don't have to chase after you after again. So please pay. If somebody has a way to get a credit card swiper and lend it to us, and you have an account, we pay into your account, and then you pay back the church later, please see Shen too. That will help us in the registration also. Amen? Hallelujah. Okay, this morning we want to talk about be strong in the Lord. This is the last of our whole series from the book of Ephesians. Be strong in the Lord. Be strong in the Lord. In times like this, we need to be strong. In when times are not so good, when times are so uncertain, when tragedy strikes, we need to be strong. I remember many years ago, I learned about this many, many years ago when I was a little boy, when I was about 13 years old, when about Form 1, I think, yeah, Form 1, and then my second brother, the one Philip, just 1 year younger than me, was stricken with a disease. We don't really know. Up to now, I really don't know, because at that time, medical science wasn't so advanced. That was 50 years ago. So it wasn't so advanced. So I don't really knew what he had, but his leg was swollen. The doctor said you had to amputate it, but my parents said, no, we'll try some other way. So they tried different ways, herbal medicine and traditional medicine, everything else. But somehow, one afternoon, when my father came to school to pick me home, I knew something happened. And that took a lot out of me as a young boy to know that the brother that I grew up with, the brother I played with, is no more around. And that taught me what it means to be strong, that I need to be strong. I need to be strong to move on in life. I need to be strong. And today, the same message can still, we still need to hear this same message, that we need to be strong. At that time, I didn't know how to be strong. But today, we know that we can be strong in the Lord. Amen? Hallelujah. Let's read this passage together, okay? Ephesians chapter 6, starting from verse 10. Finally, let's read together. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end, with all perseverance and supplication for all saints, and for me, that utterance may be given to me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that in it I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we ask, Lord, that you make these words come alive in our hearts, in our spirits, in our minds. As we hear and as we read and consider these words, O Lord, we truly, Lord, will be people who will be strong in you, Lord, and in the power of your mind. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay, just very quickly, as this is the last sermon in this whole series on from the book of Ephesians, we started by considering how we have every spiritual blessing in Christ Jesus. You know, every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Ephesians chapter 1, our possessions in Christ. In Ephesians chapter 2, we talk about our position in Christ, how we are seated in the heavenly places with Him, how we are fellow citizens with the rest of the saints, and we are members of God's household. That's our position. We are not just somebody, any ordinary person, but we are members of God's family. Ephesians chapter 2 and 3, Paul talks a lot about that. And then the last couple of weeks, we're talking about our purpose in Christ, how God has called us to walk a walk worthy of the calling with which He has called us. So Ephesians chapter 4 to 6, the last few weeks, we have been talking about how we need to walk. How do we walk? We need to walk in the light. We need to walk in love. We need to walk circumspectly. Last week, Prof took us through this, that our walk, all the do's that we need to do, everything that we need to do must be grounded in the indicatives. The imperatives must be grounded in the indicatives. What we need to do must be grounded in what God has done for us in Christ already. Amen? Amen. And how is that possible? He led us through this verse in John chapter 15, where Jesus says that, I'm the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. You will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Amen. What a great truth that is. That if we abide in Him, when we are connected with Christ, we will bear much fruit. But when we are not connected with Him, we can do nothing. So this, today, we want to continue on to talk about how can we walk? How can we walk? How can we walk the way the Lord wants us to walk? How can we live out the lives that He has called us to live out? Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Now, when we read this, sometimes when you read, be strong in the Lord, we think about how we need to add on. How we need to add, you know, okay, I'm weak in this thing. God, I will add on God's strength to that part of it. You know, it's like a tree. If it is bending down, we say, okay, we strengthen it by putting a pole under it to hold it up. We think of God as something that is just there to give us the support, to hold us up. But I want to suggest to you that when Paul says, be strong in the Lord, he's not saying that we need to add on God's strength to our own when we feel insufficient, when we feel not right. Okay, the formula, because I like mathematics. So the formula that we think is something like this. My strength minus my weaknesses plus God's power. That's what be strong in the Lord is. No, brothers and sisters, that's not what it means. You know, it is not about my strength plus God's power. No. Paul is not saying this. Paul has something else in mind when he says, be strong in the Lord. Having confidence in the flesh, trusting in what we can do, is something that is so natural. That we think that when we have something to do, then say, oh, this is something I'm familiar with. This is something I can do. This is something that I have no problem for me. Therefore, I won't do. So, trusting in our own flesh and in our own strength is something very natural. But when it comes to when Paul says you have to stand in God's strength, when Paul says you have to be strong in the Lord, what is Paul saying? Paul is saying the same thing that Jesus said. He said, without me, you can do nothing. We need to accept our powerlessness. It is not about our strength. It's not about God's tambah a little bit more to our strength to make us strong. No, it is understanding and appreciating that without God, we are completely powerless. Without Him, we can do nothing. Amen. And this is a lesson that I've been learning. You know? Sometimes you think that you're very clever, you can do many things. Sometimes in my work, I think, oh, that's not a problem, let's do this. And then, you know, then when I get in trouble, I say, oh, Lord, help me, you know. And then and life goes on like that, you know. And then if sometimes God's strength don't come or God's help don't come, they say, oh, yeah, where are you gone? No, it's not like that. I'm learning that every time I look at something, I say, Lord, there's nothing I can do about this. When I'm brought to the end of myself, I tell the Lord, there's nothing I can do about this. Lord, I look up to you. I'm powerless to do anything to change this. I look up to you, and you please do what you need to do, Lord. Amen? Amen. So, we need to stand in God's strength. When we stand in God's strength, we realize that we can do nothing without Him. So, what then do we need to do? Paul says, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. See, why put on the armor of God? Paul is saying that when you don't put on the armor of God, then you are exposing yourself to the devil. You're exposing yourself to the tricks and the devices of the devil. So whenever we are not fully clothed in Christ, I will explain this a little bit more later. Whenever we are not fully clothed in Christ, when we don't put on the whole armor of God, when Christ is not formed in us, when Christ is not fully formed in all aspects of our life, then we have exposed flesh. When our flesh is exposed, when our human nature is exposed, when our Adamic nature is exposed, we are open to the devil's influence. We become a victim of what the devil can do in our lives. What is the purpose of the armor? The purpose of the armor is then to protect the flesh. So, why do we put on the flesh? To protect ourselves, to stand against the wiles of the evil one. We put on the armor of God to cover ourselves completely with Christ, so that the devil, no exposed flesh, no human weakness, no human strength, or no human weakness that the devil can take advantage of. You understand what I'm trying to say? Yeah? So when we put on the armor of God, no human flesh is exposed. No human strength, no human weakness is exposed for the devil to take advantage of us. Paul then digresses a little bit to tell us, who are the enemies? Why do we need protection? Paul goes on to say, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, and against the spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Now, all these different people, some people have put in, or these are different levels of dominion, different levels of powers, and so on. This we're not very told very much what all these words mean. All we know that these are hierarchies of spiritual powers. These are maybe different hierarchies of how they operate, we don't really know. But they seem to have different domains to work upon. But the main point that Paul is trying to say is this, simply this, we are not fighting against people, but against the demonic systems in the world. He's saying that here we are. We are not fighting against people, but we are fighting against all the different spiritual forces in this world that dominate this world, that tries to control this world. Our battle, I want to put this up because sometimes we you must understand where I'm coming from. I came from a previous tradition where we do a lot of spiritual warfare, so we think that everything is against us, so we want to pray against all the bad guys in the country, all the bad guys in the world. They also pray against all the bad teachers who teach people wrongly, spiritual truths wrongly, and we also pray against all the bad governments in the world. But that's what sometimes we think our battle is all this. I come to realize that our battle is not all this. But sometimes on the flip side, some of us think that our battles is, we must wrestle with God and we must wrestle with the demonic forces who want to deprive us of all the natural good things in this world. Who want to cause strife in our families, who want to battle for good government. So if you got good government, then we'll all be peaceful and prosperous and everything else. We want to fight against all the bad legislations. We are going to fight for good legislation, good laws that don't simply arrest people all for everything else they say or tweet around. You know, so sometimes we think our battle is against this thing or for these things. I want to say, no, it's not. It's not. What is our battle? Our battle is for the eternal purpose of God's master plan in Christ for all of us. Our battle is to see God's master plan established in all our lives together as a church, as a people of God. That we, who are His masterpieces, bearing the image of His Son, we who He created as masterpieces in the image of His Son, may show forth His glory to all creation. Amen? That's what we are here for. In it are all the good things that we can fight for. But we need to get it clear right from the beginning. Our battle is so that the eternal purposes of God's plan in Christ, that we who are His masterpieces may show forth His glory to all creation. Amen? And the consequence of all this, when we know that we are His masterpieces, then we are good natural lives. Our family will be in order. He will provide for everything that we need. Our health will be in order. But what's the purpose? So that His masterpieces may show forth His glory to all creation. Amen? Hallelujah. So, what is Paul saying here? Paul is saying here, we will win this battle. We will win this battle when we cover ourselves with the truth of God's finished work in Christ Jesus. That's why when you come to a church like this, week after week, Sean Wong, are you listening to me? Week after week, we are reminded of God's finished work in Christ Jesus. We are reminded that God has finished it all for us in Christ Jesus. He has finished the work of creating His masterpieces. He has finished it all. We will win the battle. As we understand this, as we cover ourselves with what Jesus has accomplished for us on the cross. So we will win the battle when we, through the revelation of Christ, put on the full armor of God. When we put on the armor of God. That's why Paul, after talking about who our enemies are, Paul goes on to say, Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand. Amen. Paul says, that's the one thing that we need to do. Put on the full armor of God. What is the armor of God? Well, but first of all, let's look at this phrase, put on, take up. You say, oh yeah. You know, I don't know how many of you have been in the past, you've been taught that every morning you wake up, you put on the armor, you take your helmet, you click it on, and put a belt, you fasten it, you know, and put on your shoes, you clack it, to make sure everything is, tie your shoelace properly, put on. I want to remind you, when we look at Ephesians chapter 4, we look at this same words again, put on, take up. Remember, Paul talks about, you put off the old man, you put on the new man. And the put on, put off. Those are in Greek, the words, the tense is an aorist tense. Okay? The aorist tense means a single action that is completed in the past. When we trusted Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we have put off the old man, we have put on the new man. Same thing when we trusted Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we have put on the full armor of God, whether you realize it or not. The armor of God is covering you already, whether you realize it or not. So when we, it's just like anything else that we put on in Christ, we put on the armor of God accordingly. So put on, something that you have done. You have already put on the armor of God when you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior. When you trusted Him, you have put off the old man. Now you have put on the new man. Who is the new man? Christ Jesus. When you put on the armor of God, you are putting on Christ again. Amen? So what is armor? Well, the armor, Paul in this passage talks about six pieces of the armor. He says, stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth. So the first piece of armor that you put on is the belt of truth. What does a belt do? The belt holds everything in place. The belt makes sure your trousers don't drop down, makes sure your shirt is in place, makes sure the sword that you carry is in place for you. So the belt holds the whole armor together. And Paul says that, gird your waist with truth. Jesus does not only teach us the truth, give us the truth, but He is the truth Himself. Why? Because He says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. He Himself is the truth. And when we know Jesus, we have the truth of God in us already. When we accepted Him as our Lord and Savior, when we invited Him into our lives, the truth of God already resides in our life. What does the truth of God do? Why do you gird yourself with the belt of truth? Because Jesus Himself said, when you shall know the truth shall make you free. And when the Son of God makes you free, you are free indeed. Amen. You are free from all the legalism of the past, from all the religiosity of the past. You are free indeed to be the person that God has created you to be the masterpiece that God wants you to be. Amen? So when you know the truth shall make you free. You have the capacity, you are able to be the masterpiece that God has created you to be. John 17:17, Jesus said, asking the Father to sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. You see, when we know Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we are sanctified. We are set apart. That is the truth. We don't have to be more holy now. We are already holy and righteous in His sight. Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is true. Who is the word of God? Christ Himself is the word of God. Amen? Paul goes on to talk about the breastplate of righteousness. Having put on the breastplate of righteousness. What is righteousness? We have said this many times. What is righteousness? Righteousness is the right standing before God, the right to stand before God. If you are not righteous, then you have no right to stand before God. You have, when you're not righteous, when God don't consider you righteous, you have no right to stand before Him. So when righteousness is simply the right to stand before God. You ask many people around, say, are you ready to meet God today? Many of them say, no, wait, until I become more holy first, until I do something. You know, a lot of our friends are like this, isn't it? But good news for you, brothers and sisters. You know, God made him who knew no sin to be sin, so that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. So righteousness is the right to stand before God. And Jesus is our righteousness. Your parents may not consider you righteous. Your parents may remember all the naughty things you did in the past and not consider you righteous in their eyes. Your wife may not consider you very righteous in her eyes because she didn't like some of the things you do. She don't agree with some of the things you do. But when we know Jesus as our Lord and Savior, He is our righteousness. But why the breastplate of righteousness? What does the breastplate do? The breastplate protects our hearts. The heart as a center of our emotions and our will. The breastplate protects our hearts. When our hearts are protected, we are not haunted by our past. We are not defined by the wrongs we have done in our past. You know, I've known of people who say, for example, they had an abortion for whatever reason. I'm not suggesting that we are pro-abortion, no. I'm just saying for whatever reason. They carry the guilt for many years in their life, never coming out of that. But the moment they come to know Jesus and to know that they are righteous in God's eyes, not because of what they have done, not because of what they can do, but because of what Jesus has done on the cross, that frees them. And that's why we need to always wear the righteousness of Christ, guarding our hearts against condemnation and guilt. You know, the devil is very, very, very quick to use to use yourself to self-condemn yourself, to use you to put you on the guilt trip that you can no longer be the masterpiece that God intended you to be. Amen? You getting me on that? Huh? So that's why we need to wear the breastplate of righteousness. And Jesus is our righteousness. None other. Jesus Himself is our righteousness. And He became sin so that we might become the righteousness of God in Him. The third part of the armor concerns what we wear on our shoes. And Paul talks about the gospel of peace. Gospel simply means good news, isn't it? The word gospel means good news. And Jesus, again, is the gospel. Jesus is the good news. Why is Jesus the good news? Well, you know, way back in Genesis chapter 3, way back in creation, when Adam and Eve disobeyed God, and when they partook of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, they broke one of the God only got one commandment for them: don't eat of that tree. And the devil tempted them; they saw it was good, pleasing to the eyes, good for food, so they took it. And so they disobeyed God, and because they disobeyed, they were cut off. Because of their disobedience, they are no longer righteous. They have no standing to come before God. But God intervened. God set them apart, took them out of the garden. But God announced a plan. God announced the gospel. And God said in Genesis chapter 3, when talking to the serpent, He says, "There shall come from the seed of a woman one that will bruise your head, one that will wound your head, that will finish you off forever, and even though you will bruise his heel." That's the first mention of the gospel in the scripture. There's a first announcement of the gospel in the scriptures that there will come from the seed of a woman, one that will defeat Satan, put out Satan, bruise Satan's head completely, while Satan will bruise his heel. What is the gospel? The gospel is simply this. Jesus was bruised for our sins. And now, from that good news, he covers our heels so that Satan cannot bruise us anymore. Amen? That's what it means. That our heel is no longer subject to any attack of the evil one. Jesus has taken that attack for us. And now he covers it with the good news. Now, what is the good news further? The good news doesn't end there. The good news continues to say, and the God of what? God of peace will crush Satan under your feet shortly. Amen. We are part of it. Just as Christ bruised the head of the serpent, prophetically announced by God, way back in Genesis chapter 3. Paul now goes on in Romans 16 to say that the God of peace will crush Satan under whose feet? Under our feet, which is covered with shod with the gospel of peace. Hallelujah! God is good, isn't it? Amen? Amen. We can walk victoriously knowing that Satan's head will be crushed under our feet. Amen? Hallelujah. The fourth piece of the armor is this, the shield of faith. Above all, taking the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the evil one. You know, the devil continues to throw darts at us all the time. On Saturday early morning, 1:30 a.m., I was seated in the plane flying from Beijing to Kuala Lumpur. You know, I've been traveling so often that sleeping in a plane is not a problem for me. I get out on the plane, I fall asleep straight away. And it was 1:30 a.m. I was so tired. It had been a long day in Beijing, the whole long Friday. And then we went there to the airport middle of the night. And so sitting in the plane, but somehow I couldn't sleep. Oh. And I was listening to the plane trying to take off. And then I seem to be hearing that as though the plane can't take off. And I hear the tire sound, kung, 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 as though there's something wrong, maybe tire puncture or something like that. So suddenly the devil throw a door and say, oh, you're not going to take off. The plane's going to crash. And suddenly, for a few seconds, fear gripped me. You know, don't think that it doesn't happen. The fear suddenly gripped me. You know, for somebody who can sleep, my wife will tell you, you know, get on the plane, I sleep. And I look at my wife, she's sleeping nicely there. I said, wow. So suddenly, but then the Lord reminded me, you know, said, don't you have faith that your life is in my hand and nobody can take you off without me allowing it. And that sort of brought peace to me, and then I fell asleep and the plane took off. You know, but what I'm saying is, the fiery darts of the evil one, he throws darts at us to make us sometimes feel fear, sometimes feel, you know, whatever that you may be susceptible to. You know, I don't know why I felt like this, but I was open for a little while. And the devil threw in some darts. But praise to the Lord, I knew the faith that Christ has given to me, the shield of faith. Who is our faith? Jesus himself is our faith. Hebrews 12:2 says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Who is our shield of faith? Jesus himself, isn't it? He is the author and finisher of faith. He didn't just author it, he finishes it for us. He's a complete shield of faith. He covers us completely from head to toe. If you have seen pictures of the Roman army and the sort of shield they have, it covers all of them. And the Roman soldier holds it, it covers from all the way down. Not this picture is not such a good representation. That it is a complete covering. What is faith then? Faith is simply this. Whether we believe Jesus is who he says he is, and whether we trust him to do what he has said he will do. That's simply faith. Faith is not some mysterious thing. Faith is believing who Jesus says he is. Who is he? He's the Son of the living God. Who is he? He's the Savior of the world. Who is he? He's the one who was involved in the creation of the world. Who is he? He's the one who died for us. Who is he? He took all our punishment. Who is he? He took all our infirmities and diseases on the cross. Who is he? He took all our sins and transgressions on the cross. Who is he? He is the firstborn of all creation. He's the elder brother. And when we trust in him, we are seated together with him in the heavenly places around God's table as God's family. Amen. Will he do all that he said he will do? Yes, we need to trust in that he will do all that he said he will do. Actually, he has already done all that he said he will do. Amen? He has made it all possible for us. The helmet of salvation. The helmet, as you know, protects the head. Jesus is our salvation. How do we know that? When Joseph was told what to name the baby boy, he said, "You shall call his name Jesus." What's the meaning of Jesus? Jesus simply means the Lord is salvation. Jesus, this is the Greek form of the word, suddenly I forgot, Yeshua. Yeshua means God is salvation, okay? Jehovah is salvation. God saves. So you shall call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. So Jesus is our salvation. And the helmet protects our minds when fears and doubts come and trouble us, to try to paralyze us. It protects our mind to make us so sure. We need to be sure. You see, our spirit is secure. The scripture tells us to be transformed by the renewal of your minds. Your mind must also know that it's secure. Your mind must be wired. He said, do not be conformed to the patterns of this world. The patterns of this world is something goes out, it must come down. So what goes down will come down again. That's the patterns of the world. But our minds need to be renewed to know that everything that we need for life, everything that we need to live this life victoriously, prosperously, healthily, has been accomplished on the cross for us by Jesus Christ. Amen? And that's what we need. And then when we see symptoms, if something happens to us and that's not so right in tune with what we believe, we stand secure. We no longer are influenced by the patterns of the world. We stand secure to know that he has done it all for us. Amen. But it's not enough just to know that we have salvation. But we also need to know the salvation that we have. What do I mean by this? Well, simply, so many of us think that when Jesus Christ said he has come to save the world, we think that he only comes to save us from the penalty of sin. He comes to save us from hell. And then now we got a ticket to heaven. And that's all we think about. But the salvation that Jesus has brought for us again and again is far bigger than this. That's why in this church we keep on reminding you again the great salvation that Jesus has got for us on the cross. What is God's master plan? God's master plan is that he will have a big family. He will have many, many children, of which the one and only begotten Son is Jesus Christ, the elder brother of so many other brothers all around the table, seated with him, fellowshipping with him, enjoying all the good things that God has prepared for us. That is the salvation that he has got for us. So much more than the little things that we think about in life. He has a great plan that he wants to save all of us. That all of us may enjoy his presence, may enjoy his fellowship. All of us may enjoy his provisions. All of us may enjoy his peace. That's what Alan led us through during communion, that we are all reminded of that great salvation that Jesus has got for us. So the helmet protects our minds to think otherwise when certain things don't work out for a while, don't work out so well. But we can be rest assured, we can have that peace in us to know that He will work all things out for our good in the end. Amen? That everything else will work out for our good. Sword of the Spirit. And the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Jesus is the Word. We know this from John chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. And the Word was God. Jesus is the Word. Sometimes the Bible contains the Word of God, yes. But finally, every scripture points to Jesus. Every passage in the scripture, whether Old or New Testament, points to Jesus. And He is the Word of God. He is the full manifestation. He's the full expression of what God has in His mind when God sent Jesus. When we see Jesus, we hear God speaking to us. Amen? When we read about Jesus, we hear God speaking to us. When we see Jesus in the Old Testament, we hear God speaking to us, how much He loves us and how much He desires for us to be together with Him. Amen? So when we talk, you remember what Susan shared a couple of weeks ago, that our words, yeah, His life is in us. The life that we live is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. So when we speak, and whatever we do is an expression of the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God. Everything, every time we open our mouth to speak, words come out, words of life come out. Every time you do something, it's a touch of Jesus. And because that is His life coming out forth from us. Amen? So Paul says, take up the whole armor of God. Every part of armor is integrally connected. And every other part, with every other part, and no part is unnecessary. Every part of the armor of God is necessary. Can you remember? What are the components of the armor of God again? Okay, first you have truth, righteousness, gospel of peace, faith, salvation, and the word. Can we say it together again? Truth, righteousness, gospel of peace, faith, salvation, the word. Okay, which part of the armor? The belt of truth. Let's say again. Belt of truth, breastplate of righteousness, the shoes of the gospel of peace, the shield of faith, the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit. Amen. Hallelujah. Good students you are. Good teacher. Thank you. Okay. Verse 18. But Paul didn't stop there. Paul talks of something else. He said, and praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. Paul adds on something else here. He says there's a certain attitude that we must have. We mustn't be complacent. Yeah, we have the full armor of God ready. No need to do anything else. No. Paul didn't ask us that attitude. Paul says that the attitude that we must have is to be watchful. Everybody say, watchful. Watchful what? With all perseverance. You know, don't just watch for a while and go and sleep. And then, you know, but be watchful with all perseverance. That's our attitude. Watchful. Watchful for what? We look at it in a little while. So, and then, how do we be watchful? We are to be praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Okay? How do we be watchful? You're being watchful by praying. Now, I want to talk a little bit about prayer in a few minutes. Huh? Just for a few minutes. See, I grew up with this. Huh? I was very involved in the prayer ministry and spiritual warfare things previously. Now, I want to give you a confession. What are some of my wrong ideas of the function of prayer? Okay? So, we all know this song, you know, every time I pray, I move the hand of God, you know. So we always think that when we pray, we are moving God's hand for our good, you know. God very reluctant to help us. But when we pray, pray hard enough, God hand come, and move hand God, and God help us. You know, was that the thinking that you had in the past? That God is reluctant to help us. God's hands very heavy. Drop down, cannot come out one. I cannot help it. But if you pray hard enough, you pray long enough, He will come and help you and do something good for you. And I think that's a wrong idea of prayer. Why? Because God has already done it all for us. Amen? He has done it all for us to live a life full of abundance. Amen? He has done it on the cross for all of us already. He's not reluctant. He's always willing. He's never slumber nor sleep. That's another long sermon, okay? But we won't go into that. But a wrong idea about prayer for me in the past was this, that God is reluctant. So I must pray very hard. I must pray long enough. I must deprive myself of some things, of food sometimes, so that God's hand will be moved. You know, so a wrong idea of function of prayer. Oops. The other thing is that I question my own attitudes too, my own motivations too. So why am I in the prayer, go so involved in the prayer ministry and in the spiritual warfare ministry? Why? Because so that people say, "Oh, this guy is a man of prayer, man." You know, every Friday night, I joined the church intercessors for many years. Every Friday night, they meet at 11 o'clock after all the cell group meetings, different places. After a long whole week, I go and join them for their prayer meeting. Then we go out. Go over certain bridges and pray over all the cars that come by. We surround temples everywhere, all different things, all the different things that we have done in the past. Why? So that people, we feel good. So even though we pray against certain places of worship, that it will not be, the building may not be completed, that the building got completed, then prayer not answered. But we also still feel very good. That, at least we tried praying, you know. So sometimes prayer at night, very tired. You know? Sometimes it's a long day. So they say, kneel and pray. So I pray. So I kneel down and pray. And I'm very used to kneeling and praying because when we were growing up, we came from a poor family. We don't have a proper table to sit down for dinner. All we had was this condensed milk boxes. My parents took some, put a plastic sheet over it, and we kneel down and eat, like Japanese style, like that. Yeah. So I kneel down. So I'm very good at kneeling down. I kneel for a long, long time. But then after a while, I was very tired. I fell asleep. People think I'm still praying. Wow, this man of God, very good prayer. So we think that we have wrong ideas of praying, okay? We think of praying is all about trying to move something, trying to get a reluctant God to work on our behalf. No, brothers and sisters, that's wrong. Prayer is not like that. Just one more thing. The other thing that I want to clarify is this. Paul says, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. So many people, and because I also come from that tradition or charismatic tradition, say, that's why this is the other weapon that we have. We pray in the Spirit. Pray in the Spirit means you speak in tongues. Okay, I speak in tongues. I pray in tongues. I worship in tongues. You know, I do all that, okay? There's nothing wrong with it. And that has been very edifying for me many times. Many times in my life when I'm down, when moments I'm down, when I don't know what to do and don't know how to pray, I pray in tongues. So praying in tongues is something good, something. But I'm just saying that. But praying in the Spirit is not only praying in tongues, okay? You can pray because Paul says that praying always, what? With all prayer, with all kinds of prayers. Praying in tongues, praying in words, praying words of understanding is also praying in the Spirit. Yeah? That means when the Spirit prays in you, that's praying the Spirit. When the Spirit overwhelms you, whether in tongues or in intelligible words, that is praying in the Spirit. Okay? And Paul always makes a distinction. He said, walking in the Spirit and walking in the flesh. Right? So, praying in the Spirit and praying in the flesh. That's the distinction that we must make. It's not saying praying in tongues only, okay? So if you don't pray in tongues, The Lord will give you the gift in due course, but nothing to fret about. The Holy Spirit in you will teach you how to pray in the Spirit. When you speak something, not every time you speak in tongues, it has an effect. But when sometimes at the right time, you pray the right thing, something comes out. Something manifests completely differently. Amen? Hallelujah. God is manifested whenever we pray in the Spirit, when the Spirit influences us to pray according to His will. Now, I want to say this. Prayer is not what we offer to God. What is prayer? Prayer is not what we offer to God. Say, God, I pray so long, please help me. God, I offer you all the praise, all the worship. Please do something about my life. No, prayer is not that. Prayer is about what God has offered to us already. What has God offered to us? God has offered to us through His Holy Spirit a participation in His mind, in His burden and purpose. God, in His sovereignty, by His Holy Spirit, puts in our mind a participation, a sharing. He shares the thoughts. You know, one of the things that sometimes I when I talk to people, especially people I respect and look up to, I want to know what is in their mind. So I go to them and say, tell me, what do you think of this? And then they will share with me their wisdom. They say, oh, this is like that. And this is because of this. This is what I think will happen. And this is exactly this. God, by His Spirit, shares with you what is in His mind. What is His burden? And what are His purposes? It's not about us taking our burdens and purposes to God and say, God, please bless this la. Please lift away this burden. Please bless what I want to see happen. No. Prayer is about us receiving from God. Prayer is about us receiving from God what is in His mind, what is burdening Him, and what are His purposes. Second thing about prayer is it needs to be rooted and flow from Christ's finished work. We don't have to pray for things that God has already given. Isn't it? All we need to do is to claim what He has already achieved for us on the cross. All we need to do is to receive what He has given to us. That's what prayer is about. Prayer needs to be rooted and flow from our understanding of what Jesus has done for us on the cross. It is not about asking for some more things here and there. It is knowing that He has provided everything necessary for life for you on the cross. Amen. And prayer is this whole union communion, as we said earlier, with the Spirit of truth, of just absorbing what is in the mind and what are the purposes and what is in the heart of God and speaking that out. Lord, I know You have a burden for my brother and my sister to come to know the Lord. Lord, I thank You that You have that burden, and because You have that burden, that will be done. She or he will come to know the Lord. Amen. That's prayer. Acknowledging that what is in God's heart, what is in God's mind. So let's just pull things all together, okay? How do we be strong in the Lord? Paul tells us in two verses in the same passage. Put on the whole armor of God. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God. I always believe this. When God says something two times, you better sit up and listen. Okay? When God says something two times, you better sit up and listen. He said twice, why? So that it goes in this year and goes in the other year also and stays inside. Okay? Stay inside your mind, stay inside your heart. Many times, young people, Sean Wong, sometimes you hear something, it goes in one ear, it goes out the other ear. But when God says it two times, He says it so that it's supposed to stay in you. So when He reminds us to put on the whole armor of God, we need to put on the whole armor of God. What is the armor of God again? The belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, the shoes of the gospel of peace, the shield of faith, the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit. close your eyes, see whether you can say this or not. Then you're a good student. Can you just close your eyes and maybe, okay, let's say it again. I got to open my eyes to follow. The rest of you close your eyes, okay? Okay, the first one is belt of truth. Second, breastplate of righteousness. Third, shoes of the gospel of peace. Shield of faith. Fifth, helmet of salvation. Sixth, the sword of the spirit. Amen. You know, I just want to ask some young people to come forward and say, you know, maybe next week, okay? Okay, so how do we be strong in the Lord? How do we be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might? The scripture reminds us, put on the whole armor of God. Put on all that Jesus is to us. He's the truth. He's our righteousness. He is the gospel of peace. In Him is peace. He's the author and finisher of our faith. His very name is salvation. He is the Word of God. And we need to put this on, knowing that as we actually have it on already, but we need to actually absorb and appreciate the truths that all this means for us. And when we have put this on, we are able to stand against the walls of the evil. We are able to stand in the evil day. Amen. What else do we need to know? We need to be watchful with all perseverance. We need to be watchful with all perseverance. How to be watchful with all perseverance? By praying always with all prayer in the Spirit. Amen. Let's all rise. Hallelujah. Perhaps there are some of us here who have not trusted Jesus as their Lord and Savior. You say, Pastor, I want this armor of God. I want His truth. I want His righteousness. I want a peace in my heart. I want to have faith to know who He is and to trust Him to do what He says He will do. I want His helmet of salvation so that my mind will be fully secured. I have changed the patterns of my thought. My mind will be fully secured in that He is my salvation, that He has provided everything for me. I want the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God, which is not just a defensive weapon, but also an offensive weapon. So if there are some of us here, one or two of us here, or some of us here, who have not known Jesus as their Lord and Savior, and you want this armor of God for you to be strong in the Lord, I want to invite you, young people, old people, I want to invite you to come, to come along and share and confess and speak out this prayer, asking Jesus to come into your life. Today is as good as any time that you can do this. Today is as good as any time that you can invite Jesus in your life. Maybe this is the first time here. Say, I don't know what you're talking about, everything. It doesn't matter. Everything begins with the first step. The full revelation will come. Everything begins the first step. This is something, and you feel a tugging in your heart. That is the Holy Spirit working in you. He's pulling you to Jesus. Don't resist that. Don't give up. Don't stop there. But just open your heart now and say, Jesus, I want you in my life. Amen? So if you're one of these people, can I invite you to pray along with me this simple prayer to invite Jesus into your life? The church, let's all pray together. Lord Jesus, thank you for being my armor. Thank you, Lord, that you are the truth, that you are my righteousness, that you are the author and finisher of my faith. I thank you that you bring the gospel of peace. I thank you for the salvation, the great salvation you have won for me. Thank you, Lord, that you are the Word of God. And this morning, I receive you into my life. I want to put you on and put off my old man. I thank you, Lord, for doing this for me on the cross. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. Father, I just want to pray for all of us here that this morning, even as we leave here, Lord, Lord, we will go forth, Lord, knowing that you have already done everything possible for us to protect us from all the wiles of the evil one. Father, help us to learn how to use your armor at our time of need, and also to be secure, knowing that you have fully protected us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you have done everything possible for us to have a full and abundant life here on earth because of what Jesus has done for us on the cross. In Jesus' name, and all God's people say, Amen.